Hello and welcome to this series on genuine quotations, both spiritual and philosophical. I call them genuine purely because rather than to copy them from the internet, I took the time over a period of more than a year to take them, to lift them up from the books directly from the writings of the authors. I'm going to start this series with what I find one of the most important quotations to start with is how we create our state of being. But I need to rectify something very important. This is possibly the most misquoted and misunderstood quotation, I think, on the whole of the net. You know the one, it's the one of the Buddha, where they say that basically with our thoughts we create our reality, and that if we think positive thoughts we will attract everything we want, really happiness, beautiful partners, health, money, and so forth, the law of attraction. Now we'll see as we examine this quote that the Buddha wasn't very much into this kind of law of attraction because he knew that many of the events that happen in our life, they happen for many reasons, not just karmic, karma being one of them, another one, lessons that we need to learn. Sometime it could be just by accidents of birth, inheritance, something that we can today relate to as genetics. So what he was talking about, the happiness that we attract if we have a loving, more relaxed, more accepting mind, is very much the kind of happiness that in Buddhism they call upekkha, in Hinduism they call santosh, in ancient Greek philosophy they call eudaimonia, which means is that kind of inner relaxation and acceptance, that inner contentment that comes where we realize that things on the outside can change. We don't always get what we want and we can have surprises and we can be disappointed, but there is an inner feeling of contentment, not of the happiness, I'm so happy, you know, because I've won the lottery. Yeah, that is great too, but that is not the aim of those great teachers and philosophers. But the aim is inner peace. May the peace of the Lord be with you, kind of thing, and that kind of contentment. So let us start reading this very, very important quotation from the Dhammapada in the chapter 1. And then we'll have a little chat. I'll read the commentary that there is on the book. It's only a few lines. And then I'll end this clip as well with a few words. Mind precedes all mental states. Mind is their chief. They are all mind wrought or created, we can say. If with an impure mind a person speaks or acts, suffering follows him like the wheel that follows the foot of the ox. Mind precedes all mental states. Mind is their chief. They are all mind wrought. If with a pure mind a person speaks or acts, happiness follows him like his never departing shadow. What we place in the core of our being conditions and colors the quality of our lives and can influence many of the outcomes and events that we experience. The Buddha is not saying that we can create exactly the life we want, as we are also subject to many other influences that can determine events. What he is stressing is that the feeling and thoughts that we nurture can have an effect. both in our inner and outer life. For example, if our heart and mind are filled with feelings and thoughts of anger and resentment, we will also experience many situations provoked by what we harbor in ourselves. If we hurt and attack, we will be hurt and attacked. Often, we are not aware of this reality and we blame the world for being unfair and hostile. And the more we blame the world, the more resented we become. And the more resented we become, the more unfair and hostile the world appears to us, unaware that many of these circumstances have been created by what we project outwards. So what I'm saying is that we attract situations of conflicts, of quarrels, and so forth, not in the sense that we can attract anything that we want in some kind of mystical attraction way, you know, and we'll get cars and partners and so forth, but simply that the quality of our life can be strongly affected. If I'm an angry person, well, it's very likely I'm going to end up in quite a few quarrels. If I'm non-collaborative, and that also means that, you know, in the workplace and so forth, people will also not collaborate with us. So our profession and our work will suffer. If we resent our partner, our children, our life, and we're very unsympathetic to them, we will also get that kind of reaction back. And then we will wonder, oh, how did that happen? So, to complete, I'll just finish the few lines. I invite you to start this series of meditations by becoming more aware of your thoughts and feelings and how you react to challenges. Be aware, you know, do I always react with resentment and anger and projections of blame and so forth? Or do I try to be a bit more conciliatory, more understanding and so forth? I understand that there are times in life, and it's happening to me all the time, and not all the time, say, often, where I have to say no. Sorry, not interested, no. But the important thing is not to carry in our minds, you know, this kind of chatter, you know, how could that person have done this to me, how could they have said that, you know, it's once you have said no, once you have settled the situation, move on, and if you cannot move on outside, but at least inside, you don't let it eat you up, okay? So it's very important what we put in the core of our being. So I invite you to start this series of meditations by becoming more aware of your thoughts and feelings and how you react to challenges. Okay, we repeat that. What is the nature of your thoughts and feelings? A bit of mindfulness. Just let's examine ourselves. What is more predominant in your being throughout the day? You know, are you going around, you know, just munching something, you know, ruminating, da-da-da-da, this has done this, that has done that, with that kind of anger that eats us inside. Look at your relationships in most aspects of your life, home, work, whatever. Are they mostly based on harmony or discord? Do not judge yourself, but be honest. Remember that you can make a valuable difference to your life. Now, normally each video clip will have only one quotation and commentary. As an exception with this one, I'm going to put quotation number 2 from the book because it's a very important continuation. It really completes this first commentary very well. Okay, let's go for it. The heart is like a garden. It can grow compassion or fear, resentment or love. What seeds Will you plant there? Now, this is very beautiful. It's a very short verse, just 1.5 line, but it gives a lot of food for thought, particularly after the previous quotation, where we have seen how our state of mind, how the cultivations of our feelings and thoughts can influence us, and it can influence us how we react to people and how our people react to us. So the invitation is to think of ourselves as a gardener that is going through life just like if he was walking through a garden. And all those little acts of politeness and kindness, sympathetic attitude, you know, just not pushing people around, just sometimes giving a little smile and saying sorry if you need to, are all little seeds. And seeds are very tiny, but they can grow into enormous trees. So it's a question of having that kind of trust and faith that somehow all these will accumulate and grow. Not so much, as I said in the previous quotation, not so much in the sense that we will be wealthy and have all the things we want, but we will get closer and closer to a state of upekkha, which is equanimity, a way to look at things and to go through life and face events with a sense of inner peace and inner balance and a certain level of wisdom too, understanding how things really are, why people are reacting in a certain way and which is the best way to act, and always how to go back into ourselves and find a certain core, a certain source of repose and peace. So I invite you then to end this very first video clip on the 365 quotations, just becoming more aware, more mindful of what we carry within ourselves. And once we become more aware of it, how we can slowly and gently improve this state of being by planting seeds of reconciliation, of empathy, whenever possible. And then allow those fruits, those trees, those plants, in their own time and in their own pace, to flower. One thing I can definitely tell you after decades of experience, that they do flower. You don't know when, you don't know how, but somehow they will. Of course, we need to do them without expectation. You know, we do them because it makes us feel better, is more productive, is more enhancing. But I can say on top of that, that they do flower, trust on that. Okay, I hope to see you for the second quotation and for the many more that will come. And I like to remind you that all of these quotations are there for you in my Kindle ebook, 365 Genuine Spiritual and Philosophical Quotations by Carlo De Paoli. Okay, see you very soon. Take care now.